Welcome back at tutorial number 38 of the EEP10 Model Railway Simulator, where we are going to have a look at a control circuit for the situation where we have several tracks, multiple tracks, going into, again, multiple tracks, an N2M situation, like we could have, for instance, with a two-track junction. Well, let's just not talk about it, but see what I mean. This is one of such situations. We have a two-track lane, and well, we have a junction in both, and so we have over here two tracks, and over here we have four tracks. That's why we call this an N times M matrix. Okay, the first thing that we have to figure out before we can build a control system for this, the first thing we need to figure out, and that's why I use these colors, is what situations of traffic do we allow here? What is the traffic that can happen? Well, over here we have train on track A, and the situation is it enters over here and it just moves over there. The same holds for track B. The train enters here and it exits over there. And track B is the one that we are going to discuss in this example. Then we also have a track C, or a route C, I should say, and the train enters over here and then goes on to, well, actually on track A, so this is A and C combined together. And we also have a route D, the train enters over here and then goes over there. And that is the situation we have. Well, I'm going to discuss the situations that we have in this matrix, because we can figure out now which trains should never be in this middle area at the same time. Let's start with a train on track A. If a train on track A sends a request here, well, then it is supposed that everything is free. It is allowed over here to run over these junctions. And as long as it is in this block, a new request for train A should not be allowed. So train A should block itself. Also, we can see a train coming for route C. Well, that is obviously going to go to this track A, so that is also not allowed. Therefore, these crosses, they mean that's not allowed. Let's have a look at route B, a train that is allowed here to drive on route B. Well, that should never allow another train on route B unless it has exited, of course. Also, we can see that C is crossing it, so C is also not allowed. And also, a train that comes from this same direction for route D should not be allowed until the block is cleared. Let's have a look at route C. A train entering here on route C, well, that should of course not allow a train on track A. It also cannot allow a train on track B because it is crossing track B, and it also must not allow another request for its own track C. And finally, we have D. Well, the sensor for D, yeah, I made the drawing over here, but the sensor, the request sensor, of course, should be over there, because this is too late if the sensor is over here. But if a train for D is entering, well, that that is not too bad. It only has to block itself and trains for B. But for instance, a train coming for track D and a train for track C can perfectly run together on this track. So that's why these spaces are empty. What does this mean? How can we translate this to a control circuit? Well, the control circuit looks like this. It looks quite complicated, but actually, if you look at the colors, we have just built this not allowed matrix over here with these deviation tracks in between. So actually, this is the matrix A, B, C, D, and also here A, B, C, D. Oh, this B is not at the right place. Let me correct that, so that should be over there. So this is actually the matrix. What happens? Our control car is driving here at the bottom, and in EEP10 you can have it invincibly exit here and enter here again, so it acts as if this is a loop. The control car is in this loop. Well, let's play the situation for a train that enters here on route B. So it hits this sensor. What happens if it hits this sensor? Then this junction switch is thrown open to the upward loop. Well, suppose that all the tracks are free. Well, that means that no deviations take place over here. The control car just goes to the top part where all the sensors are. And what does it do? Well, according to our not allowed matrix, it throws a few switches, one for itself and one for track C, which is this one, and also one for track Z, which is this one. So any request for, let's say, a next request for track C, that will never enter the top of this curve, because it is already deviated here. As long as train B is still occupying this track, any request for B, C or D is simply deviated here and never reaches the top where all the sensors for the activities are. Well, the last activity is that it sets free its own switch again, and it opens up the signal over here, so the train can go. The train is released. All the other requests are temporarily ignored because the control car can never reach the top of the loop. And that situation exists until the train on track B moves over these three sensors, which reset these three switches. So now a request for C can be allowed because the control car is not deviated here anymore. Well, I hope this makes it a little bit clear. The text is over here. You can reread it yourself maybe. The essence of the case is these matrixes, they are now for four tracks, but they can be 8, 9, 10 tracks. And all you need to do is add a few of these loops and a lot more switches and sensors, of course. But essentially, it is not really complex to build. Okay, this was it on the theory of control loops. I think this is a nice situation for a next series of videos. I think one video will be too long, but let's say we build a track, then we place all the sensors, and then we place the control circuit, and then we see if it all works fine. I mean, theory is not the same as practice. See you maybe over there.